the most I know. I'm a living while I'm living, to the Father I will pray. Only He know how we get through every day. Only I give the price, I'm a live we have to pay. While our leaders play, all I see people are rip and a rob, all are grime. Thief never love is the thief with long bag. No love for the people who are suffering bad. Another toll to the poor, may God help his soul. What is most of the youth, some gets out of control. Full up on education, yet no own a payroll. The clothes from me back have countless eyes old. Could go on and on, the fool has never been told. I'm a living while I'm living, to the Father I will pray. Only Him know how we get through every day. With only I give the price, I'm a lady we have to pay. While our leaders play.
Good evening and welcome to Plain Talk. My name is Christopher Ram. Thank you for joining us for the next hour as we discuss politics with Mr. Khemraj Ramjattan, leader of the AFC, former coalition government, and now a member of parliament. Plain Talk is produced, compliments of Channel 9 on Wednesday evening, and it's rebroadcast, compliments of Channel 7 on Sunday afternoon. So let me move right into the program and say, Mr. Khemraj Ramjattan, it's great to have you back on Plain Talk.
Thanks very much, Chris, and of course, it is indeed good to be back and to have the hard questions answered, or at least an attempt to answer. It has been a while.
Yes.
And it is not my fault, it was your fault. I don't think it was my fault as much. Because, as you know, I am always one who feel that we should be leading the examined life, as it were, as politicians. And we must undergo the tough scrutiny of hard journalists like you.
I'm not averse to accepting responsibility. But as you know, getting members of the ruling party, getting members of the government to come and play talk, has always been one of the most difficult tasks. It was easy to get PPP when they were in opposition. It was easy to get you all when you were in opposition. Mr. Granger was the first. He appeared on Plain Talk on several occasions.
Yes.
I wrote him after he became president. He has never responded to me. So, but let's hope that our political culture will change and we will see the need to open up, to explain to the people. Anyway, so much for my defense. Now, this program is about you and it's about the public interest. Let me start by asking you this, Mr. Ramjattan, and I lapse into calling you Khemraj because we've been friends. We've had our public spats, but we've always been friends. It's now been 7 full months since you ceased to be a minister. You held a very prominent portfolio of public security. What has the adjustment from this big member of the government to, in a way, Citizen Ramjattan, although you're I acknowledge this, you're still a member of the National Assembly. What has that adjustment been like for you as a politician?
Well, the initial days after August 2nd, it did dawn on you that, you're not any vice president or minister anymore. The necessary privileges that you have, even having driver and a car that would zoom around in all the traffic and all of that, gone completely. But it did bring you back to ground, and I did realize that things are going to be different after 5 years of ministerial portfolios and so on. But the thing that I dreaded most was the fact that I was not in a position to continue the public security programs that I had started. And I did have a chat with Robeson Ben, who shortly thereafter was appointed Home Affairs Minister. And I indicated to him, Robeson goes back a long, long time. We were friends in the PVP, where I came from, as you know.
Was Robeson a PYO man as well?
No, well, Robeson was a PYO man long before I came on the scene.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, Robeson is far older than me. I mean, don't you notice
that? Absolutely, absolutely.
But in any event, he was there long before. But whilst in the PPP, we were close friends. And also whilst I joined up and after my expulsion from the PPP, we were close. So I indicated to him, please carry on. And he indicated, quite frankly, well, Khemraj, I will, once it is something that I see as good. So I said, fine, you're going to make sure.
Did you make this point during the budget debate, budget 2021, when you were discussing? Are you the shadow minister?
I am not a shadow minister of public security. Or
who's the shadow minister now?
Geeta Chandan. And I left a five-year, what we call a quintennial report, as to what and what we did, what and what we could not have done, and so on, with the ministry, and I'm certain that he has it. That is what is called the quintennial performance report. And it was a very frank discussion. If you would like to have a copy, I'll give you, as to what we did, the smart city, the number of police stations we made that were brand new, those that we rehabilitated, the professional training that we give policemen, firemen, and prison officers, the difficulties of the prisons, and almost everything in about 68 pages documentation summarizing the achievements and the challenges and the mistakes that we probably made. So
your colleague, the shadow public security minister of home affairs, now Ms. Geeta Chandan, has she taken on your ideas and
oh no, she has only today in a press conference with the leader of the opposition, she mentioned a number of these things in today's press conference with the leader of the opposition. And yes, of course, she has adopted almost everything, because of course that set of projects and programs were projects and programs of an APNU AFC, the coalition. We worked it out, and especially with the guidance of President Granger, who knew security very well. So it was something that we had done, and also with some very big experts out of England, Sitlington and also Russell Coombe. And then we had some experts from Canada who gave us a lot of ideas from the JES that did a lot of work about violence in society and how they're going to help in that regard. Justice Education Society is the name of the Canadian thing.
JES.
And that was the beginnings of what we did. And then within the latter part of the 5 year, a lot of projects got executed, but they were not completed, all of them. And especially the Russell Coombs report and marine recommendations from the consultant there. So that was really that, you know, I got concerned about and worried very long and hard. But of course, life is back to normal. You feel that, okay, it's there. We have our elections petition and this and that, to the extent of querying a lot that transpired in the recount and so on. But that aside, yes, you're back to ground. And I want to let other politicians know that, you know, being out of government is not a death sentence. You can go back now in parliament, as I have done, and do as best as possible you can to scrutinize the new government.
Yes.
And we are doing a good job of it. We have some youngsters also, and that is a role that I have to play, being there since 1992. I think I might be one of the longest serving parliamentarians today. Gail Teixeira is there.
Her name definitely will come up.
Yeah, since 1992.
Yes.
And there were some others. But I am with that lineage going down from 92 to right now. So we have a lot of youngsters. I have 4 or 5 of them in the AFC who are first timers that will have to now ensure that they see the ropes. And we have to help guide them in Public Accounts Committee, which David Patterson was supposed to be nurturing. and cultivating some in the other committees to understand committees work and so many other things. So we have to be there now to do it in the opposition. And it is not a strange place because, of course, I was there from since 2005 to 2015 when in opposition.
Yeah. Now, the press reports you as having played a not insignificant role in the attempt to change the results of the March 2nd 20 elections. Is that something you regret?
Regret? I never changed anything. And the press is obviously in error in relation to this.
So are you saying that the results of the elections that Mr. Mingo was declaring, was the true results?
Mr. Mingo, as we understand it as lawyers, had to make the call. Mr. Mingo was making a call that indeed we understand now had some flaws about it. But at the time, just like when Gokul Budu had made the call that we had lost the region 10 seats in 2005, when we went to 2006, right. We went and asked and we said, what's happening? He said, the call, although in error, is wrong, but we have to abide by it. Now, look, a lot of things went through our minds at that stage. But we wanted, of course, the chairperson of the Elections Commission to be the one who would make the call.
But Khemraj, you were on television a number of times saying that, look, you know, you've discovered these strange human beings here with pencils and whatever. So would you say, how do you respond to any suggestion that you were party to the attempt?
That is wholly outrageous. Never was I a party. I did ask for the SOPs. It was under the control of the region 4 APNU officials, and we were informed that indeed we had won the elections.
But you never saw them for yourself?
No, I've never. We had a team at our AFC headquarters that were dealing with them, and that team was headed by Dominic Gasquet. And, of course, a lot of things happened that turned out to be very painful. But to say that Ramjattan was part and parcel, well, they could say that. I have been, you know, directed with comments that are far more outrageous, or equally outrageous, because you really can't think of anything far more outrageous. But that how you're corrupt and all kinds of thing at a personal level, and, you know, this is outrageous.
But, so you'd say the same for your other colleagues, like Ms. Kathy Hughes? You know, you and Kathy were saying, I saw the persons from the AFC. As opposed to the name you just mentioned, Dominic Gaskin, he raised all the o'clock.
That's correct. And look, we have in our treasurer of the Alliance for Change an extremely principled Dominic.
Yeah. Is he still the treasurer?
Yeah, he's still the treasurer of our party. So, you know, at that point in time, how do we know what is happening? So we ask, who do we ask? And we ask and we got answers. And of course, the PPP were coming out with a set of numbers. When we checked a couple of them, there were some problems with them. And that is why I think a couple of days after the CARICOM team and a whole set of other things, we had to go to a recount. And of course, the recount figures had certain numbers there that vindicated that there might have been this things that were not fully perfect. But
no,
we also...
No elections is perfect.
No elections is perfect, but that is true. But also what we saw in the recount, and that is why the PPP don't want to carry us to the recount in the petitions case. They are fighting tooth and nail to avoid all those things that happened there. People who died voting. 4,000 something voters that were not in the country. And then...
But that's not been proved, Khemraj.
That has been proven at the recount,
well,
isn't it?
So...
No, here, well, we're going to have a disagreement here, and I don't want us to take...
No, but that's what this program is about. It is disagreement.
Yeah.
So you were saying that you have nothing, you do not regret your role in the 5 months following the March 2nd elections with the attempt to, by a number of players, to... rigged elections, the results of the elections.
I played no part in rigging any elections. We wanted the chairperson to make the call. Myself and the president indicated as much, that the call must be made as leader of the Alliance for Change and as prime ministerial candidate and as president and leader of the APNU, that we are going to abide by her call. If there are troubles apace with certain members within the region of the Elections Commission and so on, well, fine. We have to get the matter settled. And when the especially the CARICOM team was indicating that this thing is not going right, and even you had other people making those statements, we had to wait on that call. And one of the things that probably motivated it was, let's have a recount.
So
if indeed having that call made and supporting that call and also going to a recount is what I am guilty of, well, I don't see what offense is there to ensure that the right numbers have been laid out with all the difficulties.
One would accept that, but you would also appreciate the coalition and certain elements of the coalition were the only people trying to hold out on that attempt to rig the elections.
Well, Chris, you could come to that conclusion, but that conclusion could not, and you're a lawyer, draw a net around such a wide set of persons that you're indicating that I might very well be involved
because of statements you yourself made. You were very prominent on television.
I was very prominent on television.
My simple question was, do you regret?
No, I do not regret anything about that election.
Do you regret?
And if you would get to know what my role was, I think you would probably change. To get all of that was happening and to ensure that there were peace and not a conflagration in this country, I think I played a major role, a big role in not having a polarized, very violent scenes on the streets of especially Georgetown. The things that you had to do almost 36 hours a day on some days, if you understand my figurative language. It had to ensure that the police force and support bases of both parties not doing that which could have ended up in conflagration. So it was, in a sense, after the March 2nd, what I regard as a soft landing for this country that ensured that, fine, these are now the pronouncements to be made by the chairperson of the GCOM, and it was made.
You realize, and again I come back to the word regret, you realize that Guyana became quite not just the focus of attention, but almost the laughing stock of the Caribbean with some of the crude attempts made.
Until, of course, in America, you had the Capitol Hill incident and President Trump saying that. You know, the Americans are display God in relation to these matters.
Of course, Pompeo was opportunistic. Of course he was.
Well, fine. Well, that's what I mean.
But I'm talking about Guyana.
Well, we have always had, whenever it is so closely done, like, tell me, honestly, in 2015 when we won the elections by 4,000 votes, the PPP was saying that we rigged it.
There was an election petition, yes.
There was an elections petition, yes, that
no,
also.
But the point is this. For 5 months, this country was held at bay, if not at ransom, in order to appease, or I think you used the word just now, to give a proper landing. When the results were so very clear.
Well, it was not very clear. GCOM is the constitutional authority to ensure that clarity that you're talking about. And if a regional four-person was indicating X and Y, and we are of the view that those are the official, that official done that has to make the declaration, and the PPP didn't want that to happen, then fine, you go to a recount. A recount having happened saved the day. We must not feel that we were pariahs as a result. If it is one thing, as against a lot of other countries all across the world, and especially in developing world, you can have that going on to polarize and Syrianize your country.
But do you accept, however, do you accept this, Khemraj, that those 5 months did serious harm to the image and to the politics and to the polity of Guyana?
I would go that far, yes. it did serious harm. We should have gotten it better done. And that is why I suppose we can go on to talk about that. How do we remedy that kind of situation? And I was very pained, I tell you. It was a dangerous time. And we tried as best to avoid it. And I think the good sense of all leaders, including of the government leaders now, who was in opposition then, we managed to save Guyana. And to that extent, I am proud. And even if it would have taken more than the 5 months, I would have still been proud. The next steps now is what is important. What do we do to avoid this? And I'm glad President Ali has indicated that he would like this not to happen again. I too would like it never to happen again. And so I know all the AFC leaders and very many of the APNU leaders that I talked to, all of them have indicated we must not allow this to happen.
Interesting you mentioned APNU. Now, the APNU coalition, or the coalition, APNU plus AFC, has lost two of its members, the WPA and the GFAP. How solid does the coalition remain, and does it still meet and operate as a coalition?
Well, we meet very regularly, that is the parliamentarians. We the parliamentarians, and most of the parliamentarians in the party are also leading members of their party, like myself, Rafael, Kathy, David, Khemraj are parliamentarians. And even our younger brass, who are also parliamentarians, are also leading members in our management council, what we call our executive, that runs the party on a day-to-day basis.
But I was talking about the coalition, I'm not just AFC, I was talking about the coalition. Is the coalition operating as a coalition?
Well,
or the former coalition operating as a coalition?
Well, the APNU side is there, and the AFC. We are a coalition of APNU plus AFC.
Yes, but my question is, does it still meet and operate as a coalition?
I believe so, yes. Based on the meetings that we have had, I want to believe so.
How regularly? And give
well,
us an insight.
I don't know. The APNU component, I do not know how regularly they meet.
No, but as the coalition.
No. Well, the coalition is an APNU AFC coalition.
Yeah.
And we in the AFC meet a lot of times on almost all the issues in Parliament, budget.
No, I'm talking about meeting the APNU and the AFC together, meeting, planning strategy for, say, the budget debate, planning strategy for a legislative agenda, planning strategy for public relations campaign, and those matters. Does that happen? You see, because I think the public is looking to see how can the coalition redeem itself from the extremely negative and damaging image it brought onto itself during those 5 months.
Well, I don't. Two things. I don't believe that you're accurate when you say brought onto themselves.
Well, who did it? Nobody imposed that on the.
Well, as I said, there was a constitutional authority that has to call the results of the elections. If they were not calling or they were making a call that had problems with it, don't you think then it was right to do a recount to ensure that the call is made correct? Look, there is a narrative that some people will have that is totally in a contradistinction from ours. And that, be that, this is
a
democracy.
We're not talking about alternative facts now.
Well, no, we're not talking about alternative facts. And that is why I'm saying when people will want to say that Ramjattan is a rigger, that this thing is so wholly outrageous. We were ensuring that whatever the correct results were will obviously be announced.
But Khemraj, we know that elections, people concede straight up. You must have had your statements opposed. You know, we criticize the electoral system again. There's not a hell of a lot wrong with the electoral system.
Well,
the GCOM screwed it up the last occasion. The electoral system is pretty solid.
Well, that is what we're saying. You are now admitting that GCOM screwed it up.
Yes, of course it did, but
well, there we are.
Persons aided and abetted by you. I know,
you're saying by the coalition. Okay, well, that is what I'm saying. The narrative has sides to it, which, of course, we might not want to accept. You are saying that, well, fine, that we are the ones involved. So sad to hear that. But whatever it is, I would like to say that it was a damn good thing that it happened. That right up to after the 5 months, we got the results. And it has lots of questions as to what was found in the recall, and that has now gone to court. As to what the outcomes will happen in the court, well, fine. We are going to make sure that it is right up to the highest court and a finality is brought to it.
My point was this, the point I was going to make, Khemraj, is elections are conceded long before.
Well, this one we couldn't concede
You're not along with it. Based on statements, of course. Everybody has election agents. Mm. You must have known. You had, I think Raphael Trotman was a co-chair of the campaign.
That's correct.
Along with Joseph Harman. Mm-hmm. They must have had their computers all set up, and their cell phones and messages coming through with the results. You must have known. If you were responsible, you must have known.
Well, I have already given you my answer to that. And that answer remains, and that is the truth. And indeed, the person in charge was Dominic Gasquet. He made certain statements. I don't have to repeat them. And indeed, I was cautious enough to indicate that, please, let us see what will be the annunciation of the chairperson. And that is where it was left. It doesn't necessarily mean that, this broad sweep of personnel, well, all of y'all are riggers. Well, I don't know. The PPP was saying that since the 2015 elections, and I know how they do things. And let me tell you something. A lot of people simply want to talk about that day. A lot of people, Chris, don't understand that this thing had darkness behind it on the Facebook. I have stated the whole opinion in an interview on several occasions. I have said that. The monies that British Analytica was paid was to do a number on the persuadables in Guyana by virtue of very racial rants. Black people can't run Isle Money was one of the biggest ones. And it was directed to a lot of the Hindu community, especially Pandits. And I did not know of that until Brittany Kaiser from Cambridge Analytica said that Donald Ramatar paid British Analytica $420,000 to do that thing. They gave the advice after this lady from Trinidad had done it in the So-So campaign.
You realize you're making a really serious accusation.
It is not. I could prove that.
Okay, well.
Yeah, I could prove
you're
that.
You're a lawyer.
Yeah.
You're a lawyer.
And that is why they also went and gave the Mercury, who was an associate of British Analytica.
But tell me something. Now, yeah. I'm glad you raised this, Khemraj, because I think political parties in this country are a bunch of hypocrites. Look, you're talking about this kind of money.
Financial.
The financial misdeeds of all the political parties. All. AFC. PNC,
well, here, the AFC,
PPP, all of them have violated the laws of this country.
Well, we can say that, but the Alliance for Change, as you know, and I think you also was our accountant in this regard, we formed what is called, because we wanted to do that thing.
Yes, I
Sheila
know.
Holder wanted it, and she died trying to get the legislation passed, and she really wanted it. I think she went to Canada and so on. We formed that company, Alliance for Change Incorporated, and all our spendings go into that. We have to make returns, and that is why I am so proud of him, Dominic Gasquet. He does a wonderful job ensuring that the declaration and the returns are made annually.
I am saying, Khemraj, that the law of the land has been, in relation to electoral expenses, has been violated by all the political parties except ANUG.
Well, ANUG recently came.
Yes, and
they said,
Well, Mr.
But whatever it is, we have found that law has to be a law that is in, as we lawyers would say, in desuetude. Where do you have legal expenses or whatever expenses now being at that small figure? Contributions given to political parties are sometimes in millions of dollars.
I'm surprised that you would argue for the violation of the law.
No, not arguing for the violation. Some laws.
It fell into the state, that comes after centuries. That doesn't come after two or three elections because the PPP and the PNC said, we're going to ignore. Get GCOM. Those jokers. Oh. Get GCOM. to say, oh, we're not going to enforce Section 108 of the Representation of the People Act.
That is correct. Well, okay, if on a legal purist position...
That's the
position,
root of our problem on corruption, because political parties rely on them on undisclosed sources of income. If you're talking about money laundering, talk about the political parties, Khemraj.
Well, I can tell you that we are not involved in any
money. I'm not saying you.
Well, you know, I don't know if the PPP is, or if the APNU is, or ANUG is, or whatever is. But that is a serious allegation
yes,
you're making.
I am making it.
Well, I could prove by circumstantial evidence, too. You Why know? Did Bharat Dalal Ramatar pay British Analytica $420 million?
I don't know the details.
Oh, well, she said it. Why? And we must go back there. A lot of people don't understand.
Surely that's something worth proving. Now, what the point?
Proving the lady whistleblower.
Hold on. What I'm saying, is that when we start taking dark money,
yeah,
we are creating a dangerous political
culture. I agree with that. I am in total agreement with that, and you would have known at the time of Sheila Holder that we spoke of that as AFC members in our first term, that we must have financial regulations of political parties.
Had 5 years in government.
We had 5 years in government.
You didn't try to introduce, you talk about this law falling into disrepute.
Yeah.
You didn't try to revive it.
Well, I must say that the recommendations of one of the reports for the 2015 elections did talk about it, and that GCOM must ensure that there is an initiative on their part as to what should be the amount and things like that that you must have to declare. But I rather suspect that all the fights about chairmanship and at that level, it really never was a big...
Let's get back to this, because... We can never agree with this question of black.
No, but here, I want to tell you that I have read the literature, isn't it, that indeed political parties too, just like lawyers' offices and accountants' offices can be used for a whole set of laundering and all of that.
But at least we regulate it under the money laundering legislation.
That is correct, and that is why we need.
Why doesn't the FIU go after the political parties?
Yeah, well, I take your point. And we should very well do that. And that is why, at a very early stage, to distinctly show a difference between the PNC at that time and the PPP, we went, as advised, I think by you two, you had indicated, let us have this so we can declare at that point. I remember you...
Now, having observed what took place in the 5 months, there's a view that it will take the coalition a near miracle to restore its image among the electorate. Do you share that view?
No, not a miracle. Look, politics must be understood as a very real life thing in Guyana. And based on what has happened, the APNU AFC, or the APNU and the AFC separately or jointly, will still have massive support on the ground. I believe so.
Based on what?
Based on the fact that they have the support there already.
You mean the ethnic blocs?
Not the ethnic blocs. People see in them what we did for over the last 5 years. We got more support this time, about 20,000 more votes. When we won in 2015, it was about 200. We got 217 or whatever it was now. 17,000 or 15,000 more votes. Why is that? Because people found in us that we did a number of good things.
But did you undo it during those 5 months?
No, we did not. We ensured that their votes could have been counted. And I think a lot of them, having seen what transpired at the recounts with all these damaging illegalities and discrepancies and all of that, they will still hold bear. That's my opinion. If it is your opinion that because of that 5 months, a lot of people are going to just scatter, that is not true. Where are they going to go? They're going to go PPP? You think they're going to go PPP? When you make up your mind that the PPP is a corrupt party, as it is now turning out to be, again, all of a sudden, with how much months there? 8 months? And dismantling the guardrails of democracy, like in the PAC. They want to appoint who should be the member that is chairman. They want now to knock off the direct charge for the judiciary and the Judicial Service Commission and all of that, when under the Fiscal Amendment Act and the Constitution that provides a special arrangement for all these people. People can ask the question, but why is the PPP behaving like that?
You're raising an interesting point, Khemraj. Now, a lot of people, and you and the AFC were beneficiaries, felt, look, you know what? The PPP and the PNC in whatever, under whatever nomenclature, have not served Guyana as best as they could. And they thought, why don't we have a balancing force in the National Assembly? You had a great opportunity, 2006, 2011.
Mm-hmm.
There's a view that you've completely blown it.
It is not true. If you lived a democratic life in a political organization, you will come to appreciate that the initial position of me was that we must not do it. But if you want to live the democratic life, and I carried this to my national conference, what do we do in 2014? Do we join up? Because the polls were saying
what,
that...
What was the expression? Dead meat?
Yeah, political dead meat. And what it is that we did was to have a situation where we democratically went to our membership. And the membership heard my arguments. They heard Kathy's arguments. They heard David Patterson. They heard all the arguments. And then they decided, all right, let us give it a try. Because under our national constitution, we cannot merge to get out the PPP. So the PPP will always have a plurality like they did in 2011. What does a Democrat do when his members are saying, this is the way to go? We joined, we had a Cummingsburg Accord. A lot of people saying that it was not too tight a document. We should have gone on to do lots more. But let me tell you something. A lot of the things that we promised that we were going to do, we did. The biggest thing that used to make me very popular was the anti-corruption crusade that we must have the Public Procurement Commission. Since 2001 or whensoever, it was established in the Constitution. But it was not being constituted. Mm-hmm. Soon as we got in government in 2015, we constituted it, Public Procurement Commission, and gave it all the powers under the Constitution. When we went into government, we immediately, David Granger, this was a big point of his whole promises, local government elections must be held. It too was held in the 5 years. And there were a number of other things, like the professionalization of the police force, ensuring that they got better police stations for them, ensuring that the Russell Coombe British security from the Scotland Yard expert giving guidance to this police force. All of that we did.
Can I name one that you failed miserably on and perhaps...
Constitutional reform.
Yeah,
it is not that we failed miserably. A lot of people don't give us the little credit that indeed we had something done by Nigel Hughes as to how we go about it.
Yes, but then you didn't take it up.
It is
true. You didn't take up what Nigel...
Well, we did not. We talked about it in cabinet, and I don't want to go too much as to what happened there, but it is true. We did not go ahead with the thing, and then, of course, we had a no confidence motion and so many other things in 2019, and it kind of halted a number of the things that we wanted to do, because that kind of made you nervous about what is to be done and what got to be done and this and that and so on. But the constitutional reform, at least we made some progress until that point in time, and then we take the blame. I agree with you.
The former Prime Minister, Mr. Moses Nagamoto, was assigned responsibility for constitutional reform, and not a lot more, when the coalition was in power. Would you agree that the coalition's failure to carry out its promise in that particular regard has had a lasting impact on the politics and the polity?
Well, if you were to be, and you know the maths, although we did not do the constitutional reform, we still ended up getting 217,000 votes. So when you're going to make a statement that would have a lasting negative imprint, I want to say that the people, having heard us on the campaign trail And during the course of the campaign, we went and had interviews like you, telling interviews, and some people ask us that question. We admitted that we didn't do it, and the people still voted for us. 215, whatever. That is important to understand. I do not think that it was going to be lasting, because when compared to what the PPP did, they hardly did anything.
Yes, but this is the point.
Yeah, well, I can understand.
Governments don't like constitutions. They like this. They like flawed constitutions. They like constitutions that they can exploit.
That is a truth, and I will say that because probably we do not want to be injured in a. You see, there is a different political calculus when you're a serving cabinet member as against when you're in the opposition. I have come to realize that that is the truth about politics, and it's all across the land and all across the globe.
Is it because we see politics through flawed lens? If we were to think, what is the national interest?
No.
As opposed to what is in our party's interest to make sure we get reelected. If you were to make that distinction, don't you think it would make...
There is an element of both, I'll tell you. And I'll be frank. You know, I'm generally frank. There was calls that we should proceed as quickly a pace with this thing. I remember the Prime Minister trying his best. But then you had some people, I'm not going to name them here, but saying, well, let's hold on, that is not a priority. We wanted a number of things done also, and the priorities were given to those. But indeed, when you come out now, you can see the need for this kind of constitutional reform, that kind of constitutional reform. And at some stage, we have to now realize that since we are political parties, who could make that be that malleable, or some people say, opportunistic, we have to now come down to ground and say, well, hold on a minute, we have to do this thing because it is the interest of the country that it is done. Just like when we did it in after there was all the things that happened in 1997 and we were forced in 2001 period to come out with a lot of constitutional reforms. This kind of thing, I will bluntly and frankly state, will have to be readjusted and realigned in relation to our political perspectives.
And you recognize that the constitutional changes that we had were largely driven by public demonstrations and what could have potentially broken our country apart.
That's correct, and that is
so,
the...
I don't want to belabor the point. I think you've accepted it. That this was a major omission by the coalition government.
Yeah, well, I've conceded that. But Chris, the political reality, and I talk about the political calculus as when you're in government and all that, you're going to see that the PPP is not going to do anything. We can deal with them in a different form, probably. But that has happened. When you had the new constitution of America, it came out of a rebellion with Britain. Then when you had the human rights thing and all of that, it came after a civil war. You know, a lot of Guyanese don't know that 650,000 Americans were killed fighting each other for a new set of constitutional reforms and all of that, and the right of black people to vote and all kind of thing. A lot of people don't understand that. So,
well, the deaths didn't lead to black people voting.
No. It did,
in the 60s.
It led to the freedom of the slaves.
Yes.
It was the war against the Confederates versus the Yankees. And it must be understood.
But the point is this. In no country that wants to have sustained growth can expect to bring about change through force, through arms, through killings, true deaths.
But that is a political... Well, I do not want... That is why I told you that at 5 months period, we tried as best, and all of us, I'm not going to take any special kudos here, police and so on, to stop that from happening. And we must now understand and be smarter to understand it should not be violence that must promote constitutional reform. Although I have said a lot here about what happened in America, we must understand that it is because it is right and good and just And those concepts must be what will guide us to getting this thing done. And I think apart from all of that, it requires leadership. I am hoping that the new Attorney General, who was also there prior to 2015 and didn't do much, he is going to understand that too and to take it from there.
No one can deny that former President Granger is personally as straight a man as you can find.
I agree with that.
Yet, following his demitting of office, we have heard nothing. We seldom hear, despite major issues. Is it coincidental that both he and the former Prime Minister seem to have gone silent on national issues? Is it coincidental?
Well, I know the style of David Arthur Granger, and I want to tell you that he is that kind of person. He's not like, certainly not like me. I would come to a hard talk with a Christopher Ram, and I would go wherever it is.
And I compliment you for that, Khemraj.
Well, I believe that it is a trail that all politicians who want to be examined and live the examined life must ensure that he exercises that kind of freedom to come. But it's a style. I do not believe that he has gone silent because of anything else but his style. Self-effacing, you might say. Be a very private man, quite frankly. And indeed, he served the term after the August 2nd. Indeed, it's true, he hasn't come out openly. I have been in the ring. I have been on Burmese television almost every week since this thing has happened. And now with you, now that you have called me out, I will be with other people. And as they call me, I will come out. But I do not see anything untoward by both of them, Moses and David.
Why is Moses so quiet? Why?
Well, I think you should ask him, you know. No, you want his phone number? I could give you his phone number.
No, but he's a leading member of your EFC.
Yes, and he's an elder. Mm-hmm. And we look forward all the time for his incisive comments as to how we move and this and that, and how we act on certain measures and so on. So that is there, but I would like you to ask him directly rather than me. Propose something and he says, Khemraj, I get it wrong.
I will certainly invite him. Thank you for this suggestion. Now, the AFC, back to your party, appears to have lost credibility among the electorate. If you just look at the voting pattern, your constituency, your area, Burbis, Mr. Nagamutun, and several persons, is there a comeback for the AFC, given its electoral performance and the fact that it has been losing senior members as well, and it has not been replenishing them?
Well, that is what you're saying. We got, over the last couple of months, 48 new members from East Bank area. New members. We have gotten 100 since the 5-month period. And we have lost, just like, I suppose, after losing in elections, some people will feel that, okay, time to get on with my life. I don't think that this might be the party. Or they just wanted, for personal reasons, to come out of politics. But I do not believe that you're, even when you put your statistics to it, as to what happened in Burbis and so on, we did get votes there.
Not as much as you got before.
Well, fine.
You lost votes.
Well, we lost votes there. But we still got votes there that brought us up from 199 to 217, as I will tell you. It is not exclusively as if, you know, for the elections, we didn't do well. I mean, and so it is a kind of guesswork if people were to say that we have lost support simply because
What else can you use but the actual hard numbers come
the out. Hard numbers show that the combination.
No, I'm talking about the AFC.
No, the combination, because we didn't run as AFC. So you're not going to know what happened there in relation to AFC.
Then take the same thing. The coalition did very badly in your area and in Moses's area.
Well, even if...
And worse. Not only badly, but worse.
Well, you know, I disagree there to the extent of saying that all of that means that the AFC is doing badly.
So
when we started with five parliamentary seats the first time, then we increased to 7 in the second time. Then we got 12 as a result of an elections that we coalesced with the APNU. And then we got 9 at this last time. And more votes this time.
When you said you got, you mean you got allocated seats.
Allocated seats, 9.
It's a different proposition.
Well, it is a,
it's a different proposition.
No, it is a coalition government. And so what do you think? That it wasn't a partnership?
So my question, Khemraj, is...
We are a party that is permanently on this landscape right now. And we will do well... in future elections, whether we go with APNU as some, or whether by ourselves, and we will prove that. But the best way to prove it is if you go by yourself. We feel that, at least at this juncture, in view of the decision made in 2014 to join up, we will have better chances going together for purposes of beating the PPP. If you do not, at this stage, in my opinion, at this juncture of history, you will have a plurality and ensure that the PPP win again. And that is the difficulty we will have. You would not have had 215,000 votes in an election if you didn't have a coalition.
But my question was whether, so you don't see the word come back as appropriate if you don't think you've received.
We have been there as to a comeback, meaning that you're gonna
in other words, you've lost and you're trying to regain.
Exactly.
You're saying that you've not lost.
I am saying that based on the calculations, we got as many seats as we thought that we could have gotten in relation to the 9 that we won. So if a seat was 7,000 votes, we got in the vicinity of 63,000 votes out of the 270.
You can't seriously believe
that. All right, well, that is
what... You can't seriously believe
that. Well, if you don't believe that, I mean...
No, come on.
So how much do you think we got?
I don't think...
Exactly, but that's the point.
No. You did not get...
Don't you think that we... You don't think that we deserve the 9 seats?
If electoral support is the basis, I would say no. That's my question.
Yeah.
I say no. Because then it's about 6,000 votes per seat. That's 954. No, you didn't get that. You didn't get that. So you don't see a need to rebrand or to reconstitute in any way or to introduce new vibrant blood and leadership in the AFC?
Certainly, you got to get new blood. Absolutely. You'd have to do the things that we have been doing, asking for a better deal, bringing down inequality, the development processes that we want for the country are all that which you are there and wrote into our constitution. That is what we are fighting for today.
Don't talk about equality. When y'all are prepared to support a minimum wage of $44,000 a month.
Which we do.
But how could you expect people to live on that, Khemraj? That is cruel.
But
that is inhuman.
But when we did that, tell me honestly, you have to also watch what it is. And this is where the politics of being inside a cabinet, how do you get the money? Do you want us to borrow like a bar?
No. I'm talking about the private sector.
Oh, the private sector. Well,
the public sector minimum wage is $70,000. The private sector is $44,000. That's inhuman.
Well, tell me something. You would want us to go put up something that the private sector might very well say that shouldn't happen.
Private sector cannot be allowed to impoverish people.
Well, I agree with you there. They can't allow...
We must not be hostage. The private sector almost came out on a tirade when we had the business of the curfew at Palm Court. That is not a responsible private sector. That's almost lecherous.
Look, these are very, very difficult questions, and I appreciate that we will have to speak to our private sector. It is not as if, and you know, that is one of the things that we got blamed for. We were doing so well with at least moving public servants' salary up. That is something in the 2014 campaign, 2015 elections, we said we're going to do. We did. Okay, we didn't do your constitutional reform, Chris, but they got plenty of things that we did, and we climbed that disposable income of the public servants, passing the private sector. And the private sector, you know, they just bang us on the head that please don't touch this thing.
All the political parties, this is why all of you should get together. PPP, PNC, AFC, because all of you believe in this, the private sector is the god.
Well, not the god. I have never said that. What I am saying is that being a very important player in a free market democracy, it is important that we also listen to what they have to say.
It's free market that creates inequality, Khemraj.
No, that piece of leftism, I could understand, because I agree that they must not be allowed to have the way and then leave so many people back.
They hold the country hostage. That's what they do.
But if you believe in the market, I believe in the market to a large extent. It must be regulated. What do you do? And because when them people bring their accountant statement, and that is from your profession, they didn't make so much a profit, boss.
That is rubbish. Anyway, let's go on.
Well, let's go from your profession.
I'm watching the time. What progress do you think we've made on race relations and, say, corruption over the past, since government are now?
Race relations, I think, will always improve. Notwithstanding this negativity, more and more as the generations that are born today grow up, they watch the politics. Sometimes they tell me, no matter what they think, I like what I see with the human being that is Afro-Guyanese, and the Afro-Guyanese, I like what I see with my friend there, the Indo-Guyanese. We put a lot of this thing, because during elections time, yes, the politicians largely make it a base call, and so it takes on tribalism at the elections. But it is a choice. I do not believe that in Guyana, especially after what happened and how we managed that 5 months, that people hate each other viscerally like that, like in other countries.
But you know, Khemraj, I want to make this point because I've done a fair amount of analysis on this. People vote, this racial pattern of voting in 2020 was hardly different from the racial pattern of voting from the 70s.
Even if it is racial voting pattern, does that mean that race relations is bad?
No.
But that is the point I want to make.
So you raise it in the context of election.
Yeah. No.
So you think we're better off race relations when you have all these accusations, or you're ethnic cleansing and you're just getting rid of this person, that person?
Well,
you think we're any better off in that regard?
Well, I believe that honestly, to make space for certain of their ethnic groups in the PPP there, they did knock off some of them to create space. And that will always happen. Just like if it was a homogenous society.
We all did the same thing?
Well, no,
did you all do the same thing?
We did not do the same thing.
Did you bring in a whole set of new people?
That is not true. In my ministry, public security, not a single soul.
I talk about government, Jeff.
You got to tell me where the government happened.
So you're comfortable with the state of race relations?
I am comfortable with it, but it can still be evolved into a better state of play.
You're comfortable with the measures and the structures to deal with public expenditure and rewarding friends and party people.
That is happening plenty now, boss. With all that has happened
in Vietnam.
That is corruption. We've seen too.
Why didn't you all set things in place to prevent this?
Well, that is what we did, as much as we
so
could have done.
Happening?
Don't feel that. Look, we got laws against murder. We got laws against murder. Murder still happening?
I'm on a government and a murder.
No, it is.
You got 2 minutes. Go on. Go on, Khemraj.
No. Here. We did a lot for the Public Procurement Commission, financial arrangements. Winston Jordan tried as best as possible. That fiscal amendment the amendments we made, all are now being dismantled. And also what they brought in with a GRA in Stacia to ensure that we have the enforcement to go after these same private sector people. That is why we managed to get more resources and revenues.
You know, I really must bring you back because we got lots of other things. We got to talk about
it.
I want to raise one final point because the red light is on. You all have been very silent on this 2016 petroleum agreement and the way the whole oil has evolved. Now we know that the model, and I say this in exoneration in some respects from you, the model of the agreement signed by Trotman, Minister Trotman, was a PPP creation. They may not like to hear that. It was a PPP in 2012. Ask Robert Pazard about it. But the fundamental and conceptual mistake that Trotman made, he used a pre-discovery agreement or a pre-discovery model for a post-discovery situation. Why are you all silent?
We're not silent. We had to make a decision. And the decision had to be made very early so that we could get the oil the earliest. We were hearing that renewables are going to come on stream in another 5 years, and we were in 2015. What do you do? We were hearing that the prices of oil can come down or can go up by 2020, and we will make a big profit. Sign it. I was one of them that went for four reasons we discussed. Well, could we alter it? No. Well, what will happen if we try to alter it? The people will walk away.
But you agree with me that you use a post-discovery environment situation.
That's correct.
To apply to pre-discovery.
Yes, and we said we're going to change it once we know now they come here and they put up their forest oil platform. Because once here, they're not going to go away like
you
that.
You can't change the agreement.
That is another thing. You couldn't change the agreement, but you could have asked for a better deal.
No, well, that
would... And we got a couple of things.
That would be renegotiated.
All right.
Anyway, Khemraj, Mr. Ramjattan, I want to say thank you very much. It's always interesting talking with you. Good discussion.
Good times. And I would like to be back here for some other things in Swan.
I really would like to talk with you about our international relations, China, and its injection into this country and economy. Operators and viewers, thank you. Good night. This program will be rebroadcast on Sunday afternoon on Channel 7. Until we meet again next week, do enjoy a long holiday weekend.
A very good night to all of you. Thanks.
Until the philosophy which owed one race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned. Everywhere is war. It's a war that until there are no longer first class and second class citizens of any nation, until the color of a man